Anyway, I'm excited. I have a guest in the house today, and I've been talking about this, bringing somebody in that could help us understand a lot more about acreages in the context of habitat improvement and wildlife habitat improvement, which we talk about on the show all the time, but usually in the context of what other organizations like the National Wild Turkey Federation and some other organizations, Ducks Unlimited, do in order to improve wildlife habitat. But I actually have a forester. I actually found a real live forester that doesn't work for the government. That a few weeks ago, if you remember, I had Jason on. We were talking about the Quality Deer Management Association, QDMA. And one of the great people I met, I was just like, you know, sometimes life, just the intersection of life is you just never know who you're going to meet and when and how and where. But things, good things happen at the right time. And so I met this this person. Her name is Kelly Nywening. Did
yes,
I get that right?
Nywening.
I just, you know, I knew as soon as I approached it. But anyway, Kelly is with us today. Good morning, Kelly.
Good morning.
And Kelly, is your mic on? Okay. And so Kelly is a forester, a real live forester. And Kelly, I've been talking to folks about wildlife habitat improvement on their lands. We've been talking about, you know, how states manage their forests. And so I'm glad to have you on the show, because when I found out what you did at that QDMA dinner, I was like, whoa, I've got somebody that actually works in the field actively right here in the region, right here in Orange County. And again, you're building a forestry practice mm-hmm. here in the county, and very busy. We were talking before the show. Tell us, Kelly, a little bit about your background. How did you get into forestry?
Well, honestly, I got into forestry on a whim. I was in the market for a career, made a new friend who's a forester. When he was telling me about his day-to-day, what it is that he does, his expertise, it sounded like it was right up my alley.
Hmm.
That was actually out in Colorado.
Right.
When I got back here to New York, I looked into programs that were available for forestry, and I found the SUNY System Environmental Science and Forestry College up in Syracuse, New York.
Right.
So I applied, got in. Never look back.
Never look back.
No.
Now, and you're local. Your family has a farm in the region,
in Chester,
right? In where?
Chester.
In Chester. Mm-hmm. So she has a farm. So she had all the elements there. So, and you were out. I mean, so you did 4 years at in Syracuse,
mm-hmm.
completed that, and then you worked for the Forest Service after that. Talk to us.
Right. I worked for
that.
The U.S. Forest Service, for the federal government out west. While I was in school, I actually started working for the Forest Service on the Coconino, which is in Flagstaff, Arizona. Really beautiful country. And while I was in school, I got hired with the Forest Service to do timber sale preparation in northeastern Utah and Vernal, which is the Ashley National Forest.
Okay.
And from there, I went over to Gunnison, Colorado to work on the GMUG, the Grand Mesa, Uncompahgre, and Gunnison National Forest.
Okay.
Timber sale administrator.
If you say so.
I say so.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. So how long were you with the Forest Service?
So I worked for the Forest Service for 8 years.
Oh,
I
wow.
think. And I wanted to start my own private consulting forestry company.
Right.
But out west, for those that aren't familiar, the majority of the forest land is owned by either the BLM,
right.
the Park Service, or the Forest Service.
Yeah.
Not a lot of private property to work with. And I realized
True.
That my radius for my
mm-hmm.
business would have to be huge,
yeah.
stateswide, to find enough work to continue
right.
to live out west. So I decided to come back to Orange County, where my family is, and start out here.
I guess my first question before we go to the first break is, what qualifies someone? How what is the minimum size of a lot that you would work with somebody to make a significant impact?
I would say, just as a rule of thumb, down to 10 acres is a manageable piece of woodlot for
okay.
specific objectives, possibly not for commercial timber production,
mm-hmm.
but possibly. If you've got 10 acres of black walnut, you might have a valuable property, perhaps more so than 100 acres of,
mm-hmm.
let's say, beat up red maple. So it really
right.
depends on the property. It also depends on what's adjacent to it. If you're adjacent to state lands, if you're adjacent to neighbors that aren't managing, if you're adjacent to farmlands, you can provide some unique habitat, even on
okay.
a small piece of property, just
right.
by looking at the greater landscape.
Okay, so that's good news. So good news there, folks.
Yeah.
Those of you who think, well, I don't have, you know, I have 25 acres, or I have 30 acres, or I have 10 acres. Hey, 10 acres is, you know, again, for what you're trying to establish, it's got to be connected to specific goals. So if you want to improve habitat, or you want to just make sure, you know, you're not getting some kind of infestation in your trees, which we can talk a little bit about today, too, because that's a big deal across the United States, not just here in New York. So, you know, let's do this. Let's go to the break if we can now. And then welcome back. You're listening to the Dirks Outdoor Show with your host, Dave Dirks, in the studio. And with us today, if you're just catching us now, we have Kelly Nywening, who is a forester and is a practicing forester here in the region, has a growing forestry practice. I was talking to her before the show. Kelly, you're telling me you've been really, really busy helping people evaluate their lands for a lot of different objectives, of which we're going to talk about two today. One is wildlife habitat. And she's going to help us shed some light on some of the basics of what landowners who have smaller lots, which a lot of folks do, some have larger, what they can at least think about in terms of managing their land for optimizing it against wildlife or improving wildlife. And then, of course, we'll talk about a little bit about forestry itself. I want to start, Kelly, with sort of the definition between, what's the difference between a logger and a forester? Let's talk about that. Can we start there?
Sure. So a logger, as everybody is probably familiar with from all the reality TV shows.
That's true.
Yeah. Is a guy with a saw or a machine who is cutting down trees for a specific purpose, which the forester is the one who determines. So a forester is more of a planner. A forester is the person you want to go to for evaluation, for knowing what your trees are worth, whether that's for timber or if it's for a wildlife habitat objective. Right. And that's not to say there aren't loggers that can plan these objectives for you, but the forester's primary goal is to represent the landowner in dealings with loggers, with sawmills.
Okay.
With whomever else is going to work on their property, to represent the client's objectives, to help the client set objectives if they're not sure what they are, to help them realize what the long-term goals should be and how to best work towards them.
So if that's the case, I've got 50 acres, and I do want to make sure that, you know, for the 50 acres I've got, I've optimized it as best as I possibly can to make sure that the deer and the turkey that run through my property have everything they need to sustain themselves, or just, you know, to make sure I have a healthy property. Mm-hmm. Where do I start?
Well, I would say in Orange County, chances are you don't have a healthy property. And the reason is that deer population here is extraordinarily high.
Yes.
And when you walk into the woods and you can just take a stroll through as if you're in a park, that's how you know deer grass has gotten out of control.
Where it's all cleaned out.
Absolutely. Yeah. They're just eating every little tree seedling that pops up in the woods. So chances are you don't have a healthy functioning system. And that's the case through a huge amount of New York. Even if you're opposed to logging, I would probably recommend we consider cutting some trees.
Right.
Whether or not we're taking them out as a commercial product is almost besides the point if your objective is wildlife management. Mm-hmm. But creating green on the ground is probably your first course of action really anywhere in Orange County.
Right. So you're saying that, okay, you may have to decide, assuming my purpose is I want to create the most optimized wildlife habitat I can, maybe taking out some trees is my opportunity. What else am I going to consider?
Like I said before, you're going to consider the landscape as a whole. So to optimize for really any wildlife, you're optimizing for diversity.
Okay.
Absolutely. So a diversity of forest structure. So either you've got a low brushy cover close to the ground, or maybe you've got large mature oak trees 100 feet up in the air and everything in between.
Right.
You want to maximize the diversity. Now, again, if you've only got 20 acres, maximizing diversity on 20 acres
it's
going to be limited.
Right.
But if you can look at the broader landscape, you can see what structural states are lacking adjacent to your property, and you can create that on your property.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So let me ask you this. So you and I, we go to my property, and I want to kind of look as best we can through your eyes. So you have trained eyes to look for certain things when you enter the property. Just kind of walk us through what you're trying to evaluate and look at, just if you don't mind, just kind of high level here.
Sure. So I guess we'll start from the literal high level.
Okay.
We'll look at the overstory tree composition for tree species. Again, there are certain trees that are more valuable for timber than others, we'll see if we've got valuable, manageable saw timber sized trees.
Okay.
Or if they're not, but they're still valuable for wildlife.
Mm-hmm.
So things like aspen, not valuable at all for saw timber, really valuable for grouse.
Right.
So we'll see what we're working with to begin with.
Okay.
By the time I've gotten there, I've already looked at the soil types. I've looked at a landscape map to see what we've, what we've got adjacent to the area.
Okay.
We're going to have a talk about your objectives as a landowner. To me, that's the most important thing. What do you hope to accomplish here? How long have you owned this property? How long do you plan to own this property? Do you want to leave this property to your kids? Really set the stage for what you as a landowner is hoping to accomplish.
Right.
And then we'll look at the, as I said, the overstory tree composition and health. As you mentioned, there's a lot of insect and disease outbreaks.
Yeah.
I think everybody's probably at this point heard of emerald ash borer.
Oh my gosh.
You know, do you have ash trees that are
yes.
in imminent danger?
I have a ton of them.
Right. And are that something you'd like to take the value out of before they die? Kind of pressing forest health issues. And then we'll kind of move our way down towards the ground. We'll look at the midstory. So the midstory are trees that are sometimes younger, sometimes not, than the main canopy, growing in the midstory because they're tolerant of being shaded by large trees.
Correct.
If there's a lot of shade-tolerant midstory, it's catching the sunlight that dapples through the overstory before it can reach the ground. Perhaps we want to take out some of the midstory. Again, either because it's not valuable ever as timber, or it's just not a valuable species for our objectives.
Right.
And from there, we can look at the ground cover. And like I mentioned, in New York, chances are tree regeneration is terribly lacking. And by regeneration, I mean seedlings that are growing, that are healthy, and that are a desirable species.
Right,
if we're managing for oak, we've got oak seedlings ready to come up through the tree canopy, if there's any.
You're looking for that as you kind of go
looking
through.
Looking for that, looking for populations of invasive species, also a really common problem in Orange County and northern New Jersey particularly. There's some, out west we'll call them noxious weeds.
Okay, right.
Here they call them invasive species. Yeah. Common ones are Japanese barberry, multiflora rose, oriental bittersweet, that can really interfere with your objectives because they don't have a high wildlife value. Even if they have, you know, some value as cover, perhaps they're not providing any browse or they're not providing any food.
Right.
And they're also inhibiting the space available for regeneration to come
up
here. So we'll take a look at that. We'll look for erosion issues. We'll look for access issues, just physical infrastructure, either problems or opportunities that you're going to be able to use to access your property and allow us to do management. And we're going to put that all together into one plan of action, perhaps a 10-year plan, a 15-year plan from where you are now and where you want to be with your objectives. And how we can move you there.
Okay.
So there's actually,
we
can get to this whenever you'd like, but there's a lot of programs available to assist landowners with that process.
Right. Okay.
Yep.
Well, that's, I have to tell you, so folks, what we're saying here is there's a lot more that meets the eye in terms of managing any size lot. And if you've just listened to the evaluation process that Kelly just walked us through, she's looking at everything from the very top to the very bottom. And then of course, making sure that whatever she sees is in line with what you're trying to do with the land. So, you know, there's a lot of thinking that goes on here that I think is missed. And I think, you know what, to be honest with you, Kelly, I think people try to, without people like you inserted into that discussion, people tend to do, I think, really bad things to their properties. Because they're, I'll tell you why, because they what they're doing is they're listening to Fred or Sally, and you know, you ought to do this, and you ought to do that, and I heard this, and then nobody's a forester there. Nobody really knows what they're talking about, per se. I mean, I'm just saying, like amateurs like me, I have no right to go in there and say, yeah, I think you ought to do this with your property, but I've heard a lot of people have this. So rather than do the haphazard thing, what you're suggesting, Kelly, is that you really need to kind of, there's an investment here if you're really serious about doing this, right?
Yeah, there absolutely is, and I agree with you. I don't want to insult landowners and their...
I will if I have to. That's my job.
I really appreciate landowners with a level of enthusiasm, you know, so I don't want to put a damper on anybody's hopes and dreams necessarily, but...
No, I get it.
I do agree that there can be an amateurism in a lack of experience.
Of course.
So maybe this is another difference between a logger and a forester, is that there's decades and decades of research available to help us understand the probable effects of a treatment.
Right.
And I think it's the rare landowner that's consulting, you know, peer-reviewed journal articles to see what are the odds that if I perform this treatment, this will be the result. And so I think people can fall into pitfalls.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes those pitfalls can be very hard to climb out of because are overstory in this part of New York are overstory oak trees. If you just walk into what looks like a lot of people call old growth, mm-hmm. a large oak forest. They're about 85 years old, generally. Wow. They originated in the 30s after farm fields were widely abandoned.
Yep.
So they're all about the same age, about 85 years old. They take a long time to grow. They take 85 years to grow back. So if you cut them down, you can't stand them back up. So I think it behooves people to really plan ahead.
Right.
And there is, as you said, a lot of advice out there. I just read an email from a we won't name them, from a habitat group that suggested cutting oak trees to produce acorns. And I completely agree with that. If you free up the crown of an oak tree by cutting an oak tree next door to it, the one that you leave.
I get it.
However, there's a right way to do it and the wrong way. And again, they're 85 years old.
Right.
And if you cut one down, it's going to take 85 years to grow back.
Right.
So just having the voice of experience to suggest, well, which is the better oak tree to cut, which is the better one to leave. I think that's something that people don't necessarily realize. I also think that there's a lot of unintended consequences. We talked about invasive species a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, if you walk into your woodlots and you start hinge cutting red maple poles or browse, that sounds like a good thing to do. And it certainly could be. Well, if you've got invasive species already established on the forest floor, that's what you're going to promote.
Right.
And so just looking for those probable pitfalls for people, I think is a valuable service for a forester.
I think it's huge. I think it's huge. Like I've been around and I talk to people all the time and I rarely run into anybody. So, which is good. So you're creating a practice that's really focused around helping people do better with what they've got. And listen, land is not cheap. So I'm thinking if you're going to buy land these days, you should be doing something and working with people like you. Listen, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back from the break, at the Dirks Outdoor Show, we're going to talk more about wildlife habitat improvement with Kelly Nywening. Stay with us right here. We'll be right back. But we started talking about pitfalls. There are certain things that you see landowners do that you want to help them prevent people from doing. But let's talk more about those pitfalls. What are some common pitfalls that you see in terms of forestry or wildlife habitat management?
Well, I think generally, like I was saying, a lack of long-term planning is the most common.
Okay.
Probably more specifically when cutting timber, which I know a lot of people are opposed to, but an awful lot of people are pro, especially when there's a check to be gleaned
sure,
at the
absolutely.
End of the process. And that's perfectly fine. That's one of important objective of ownership. But when doing a commercial timber sale, there's a very common phrase promoted by foresters who are possibly less long-term focused and or loggers, wherein people will say, cut the big trees to leave the little ones grow. Well, as I had already mentioned, the little ones are often species that are less desirable for timber, black birch, red maple, etc., that are able to grow in the shade. Or they're trees that are the same age as the big ones, but they've been growing more slowly either because they're on a bad site or they've got bad genetics.
Right.
And those trees will never respond positively to a harvest. So people will go through and pick off all the big trees and be left with a denuded resource that they think is going to provide them more cash flow in the future, and it doesn't.
Right.
That's a very common pitfall.
Yes. So in general, are there any other common pitfalls that you see landowners doing besides not long-term planning and necessarily maybe?
I think a lot of people aren't either aware of or haven't availed themselves of programs that are available to assist landowners. You had mentioned that buying land is expensive.
Yes.
Well, maintaining land is expensive. Paying taxes on land is extremely expensive, depending on what part of the state you're in. There are actually programs available to help people with their taxes. Both in New York and New Jersey. In New York, the program is called the 480A Forest Tax Law or Fisher Tax Law. And in New Jersey, it's actually part of their farmland assessment program.
Okay.
But there are programs that offer reduced tax assessments for people who are actively managing forest land. I think a lot of people aren't aware of that.
No.
I won't get into the details. I'll just say briefly, in New York, you need 50 forested acres. In New Jersey, 5 forested acres.
Okay. So, wow, big difference.
Big difference. So, somebody with 20 acres isn't going to qualify for that program. Right. However, there are other cost-share programs that can help offset the cost of active management.
Mm-hmm.
One's available through the NRCS, which is the Natural Resources Conservation Service.
Okay.
It's under the U.S. Department of Agriculture. It's a federal program that has cost-share money for a landowner to get a management plan written, but then also to do what they're calling conservation practices. So let's say instead of cutting the expensive valuable trees, we're going to cut the less valuable trees and leave the better ones to grow bigger and more valuable, whether that means for timber or for wildlife. Yeah. There's a lot of programs available for people within the watershed of New York City, which you'll have to consult the internet to find out if you're in that, generally up in the Catskills, also east of the river. The Watershed Agricultural Council has awesome cost share programs to manage for wildlife habitat, for tree cover, and for erosion control.
Big time,
big time. It's, when you're building roads, when you're doing logging, they've got a lot of good programs available to help people with that. With the intention of keeping the watersheds that fill the big reservoirs that go down in New York City to keep them pristine. So I think not collecting all the information available is a big pitfall that people run into.
Right.
Also another reason to consult a forester before you start management activity.
Clear life. So Kelly, I want to go back to something you mentioned about invasive species, which I know is a big deal because I know, you know, forestry service, states are battling things like the ash borer. What's the update on that here in New York State in terms of, I know there was a big deal, you couldn't move ash across state lines and there were some other regulations and restrictions over the last couple of years on.
Yeah, so they still do have a quarantine zone.
Okay.
So you can't move ash or firewood of any kind outside of where the beetle ori has been detected. Well, it's been detected in most of the East Coast.
Like everywhere.
The quarantine zone's so large that it's almost inapplicable any longer.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the ash borer it's very active in Orange County, up into Sullivan County, and it's moving towards Delaware County. New Jersey, it's very spotty for some reason. There's more of it to the south. Sussex County and Passaic County, there's really only limited population. So anybody who has ash in northern New Jersey, I recommend they take a look at it quickly.
No. So other invasive species that a landowner might, you know, that's very common outside of what we've talked about already.
Yeah, gypsy moth.
Gypsy
moth, I think everybody's probably familiar with. It was actually brought in it was one of the first invasive species to arrive in this country. I think it was 1769, if I recall the exact year it was introduced into this country from Europe, obviously. And it's done a lot of damage to white oaks, particularly.
Right.
If you look at the west side of Orange County, you'll see standing dead white oaks, including chestnut oaks. That's from a gypsy moth outbreak. That can be a really big problem, but it's cyclical. So when people start seeing, and it's more than we can probably talk about right now, but you can look it up on the internet. If you start seeing a lot of egg masses from the previous year, you'll know you're going to get a big hatch.
You're getting ready,
the coming year, and it's something you might want to consider if you've got valuable timber.
Wow.
Whether that's for timber, if it has an aesthetic value to you or a wildlife value to you, or just the overall property value, if that matters, that's a hugely problematic invasive insect species.
Yeah, no question about it.
Everybody's talking about the spotted lanternfly, which is coming our direction. They found, I think, one fly in Port Jervis last year, but just one, and it was dead. But it's inevitable.
Well,
it will be in New York.
If there's one,
the next couple
we know
years.
There's more, right?
It's possible, or it was just brought in.
Really? What's the deal with that?
So that,
what did you call that again?
Spotted lanternfly.
Spotted lanternfly.
Yeah, it's a serious pest of particularly agricultural products.
Okay.
So if you have hops vines, you should be worried. Grapevines, you should be worried. Oh. It weakens trees.
Mm.
It doesn't seem to kill them, but that's another one that's coming
crazy
our way.
Stuff out there.
There's a lot.
I mean, crazy stuff. It's unbelievable, but true. Listen, we're going to take another break. Stay with us. We've got more to talk about: wildlife, habitat management, forestry. This is a great Dirk's Outdoor Show. Stay with us. We'll be right back. So Kelly, we were talking before the break as well about some of the problems with invasive species. You mentioned the ash borer. We've got, you know, gypsy moth, which has been around for a long time. You mentioned that beetle. What was that beetle you just mentioned?
Spotted lantern.
Spotted lantern beetle, which is now a problem. And are there any other invasive insects or major plant issues out there? I mean, I know that are, you want to talk about real quick?
There are a number of emerging insects, also things you don't think about, such as nematodes. There's some bacterial diseases. Oak wilt, I think, is something a lot of people haven't heard about, that we're finding more and more of as as science progresses in its ability to recognize different pathogens, mm-hmm. a lot of this requires gene sequencing okay. to realize that like a fungal species is different than another. So it's really kind of a cutting edge field.
Sure.
And unfortunately, they're more and more cropping up. These things can travel the globe right. now. Wow. And they do. That's how things get here, yeah. honestly. A lot of the emerald ash borer was in pallets coming over from China.
Right.
You know, the Japanese stilt grass was packing material. Likely spotted lanternfly was either ornamental or nursery mm-hmm. stock. So plants coming directly right. from China or, again, on packing material. So things, they will continue to crop yeah. up. We're going to yeah. find it's, more it's, and more diseases.
It's never ending, yeah. really. Unfortunately, yeah. it's a bad cycle. So as we kind of wrap up the show here, let's kind of recap a little bit for folks. If someone has a woodlot, let's say, you know, 10 acres or more, and they want to do something with it, what should be their very first step besides contacting you or a forester like yourself? What else should they be thinking about?
I would
about?
Recommend they do some research.
Okay.
And also I would recommend talking to neighbors or friends who have had active management either mm-hmm. done or done themselves on their property.
Okay.
And perhaps the best way to find these people is to join organizations like QDMA
okay.
that we had met at or right. the National Wild Turkey Foundation, mm-hmm. etc., and try to find like-minded people who might be able to give you the voice of experience that you just might not have in that case, or perhaps give you some ideas that you might not have thought of yourself. So I'd recommend that.
Yeah.
I'll also say that the National Wild Turkey Foundation has she's not a forester, she's a wildlife biologist, but she does plans from the perspective of managing for wild turkeys that's available on staff for okay. landowners that they can contact free of charge, actually,
okay.
if wild turkeys are something you're excited about. There's a lot of resources out there to avail yourself of. I think people need to just pick up the phone and make a call, and they'll be surprised by what they find.
Yeah, that's excellent, and that's great advice. And I have to tell you, Kelly, I really do appreciate the fact that you were able to take the time out of your busy schedule to join us. We're hoping to do some more work together, maybe collaborate on some videos, mm-hmm. If you don't mind me saying.
Absolutely.
So this will be, we're kind of looking at this, Kelly and I, as sort of a way to kind of get invested with really helping people understand the proper and the correct ways to manage their lots. Whether,
and I'd
again,
say, I guess, if people have specific questions, they should leave them on your YouTube comments?
They can do that, or I would even encourage them to go to your website. Again, sure. Give them your website and your Gmail address.
So it's just sawtoothforestry.com or at gmail.com.
That's right. And just you can send her. Now, if you send the questions to me, again, you can reach us here at dirksoutdoors@gmail.com. Mm-hmm. I'll be happy to forward them to Kelly, and you can go from there. But Kelly, I've really learned a lot. I expect to be learning more with you and from you as we move forward, and hopefully do some work to help other people understand how to best get the most out of their properties.
Great. Yeah, looking forward to it. You bet.